Our speaker today is Guillaume Lampe. He studied mathematics at the École Polytechnique in Paris and then moved on to Carnegie Mellon to do a master's degree in natural language processing. He moved back to Paris to do his PhD, which he finished in 2019. And he is now a research scientist at Facebook AI Research. A lot of his work centers around machine translation in an unsupervised way. And he has been awarded with the best paper award for his work on this topic for one of the major conferences in the field. The topic of his talk today is not going to be language processing or machine translation per se, but rather what understanding this topic can teach us when it comes to manipulating symbols in mathematics. So on that note, please, Guillaume, the stage is yours.
Hi. Thank you for inviting me. So I'm Guillaume Lampel, and today I will talk about deep learning for symbolic mathematics. It's some work that we recently published at the iClear conference. So the motivation behind this talk was that if you look at current results in deep learning with neural networks, is that neural networks, they perform extremely well on a wide variety of tasks. For instance, in computer vision, whenever you have to classify images, when you want to segment objects in an image, or even if you want to like recognize faces, if you want to recognize speech, or even in natural language processing, for instance, if you have problems like a machine translation, so let's say translating automatically from, let's say, English to French, or if you want to classify whether a sentence is expressing like a positive or a negative sentiment. For all these problems, whenever it involves classification, neural networks work really well, and they are mainly state of the art in most of these tasks where we were able to apply them. But so what we wanted to see is whether it's possible to use neural networks, but in mathematics. So people have tried, but the problem is that there has been a very limited success in symbolic computation with deep learning so far. So surprisingly, what we have is that neural networks, large neural networks, they can be pretty good at, let's say, translating English to French. But this model will actually perform very poorly whenever they have to do some very simple arithmetic tasks. For instance, integer addition, or even if you ask a neural network to multiply two very large digits, let's say two numbers with five digits, it will actually fail. Or it will actually succeed, but only like in 80% of the time, so it doesn't work really well. And the thing is that most people in the field of deep learning for symbolic math have actually focused on these very simple arithmetic tasks. The reasoning being that if neural networks are not able to do addition and multiplication, then there is actually no hope that we can use neural networks to perform some complicated math, like solving theorems or like computing integrals or solving differential equations. But the thing is that actually humans are also not very good at this. If you give somebody like two large number of five digits, it's unlikely that somebody can actually compute the product of these numbers. Or at least people have to write it down. They cannot like mentally compute this very quickly. So, but still humans are actually pretty good at like solving theorems on like computing integrals. So maybe we have only tried so far to apply neural networks in mass, but on the bad problems. Maybe neural networks can be used in mathematics, but maybe they will actually perform better in more complicated problems than addition and multiplication. So this is what we wanted to see in this paper, is whether it's possible to apply neural networks on more elaborated tasks, knowing that they actually don't work well on simple tasks like multiplication. So we focused on two different problems in mathematics. So one is a function integration, and one is solving differential equation. So the nice thing about these two problems is that they can be seen as a particular instantiation of a machine translation problem, where instead of, let's say, transforming like an English sentence to a French translation, what you will do here is basically map, an expression, a function, to its integral. So you basically have to translate like a problem into a solution. All neural networks perform really well in this task, like sequence-to-sequence model. Sequence-to-sequence neural networks are very well studied and they perform very well. So we can see maybe whether they can be used for these problems. And it's also one of the reasons why we had some hope that neural networks may work well in this problem is that it's also a problem that involves pattern recognition. For instance, if a human is trying to actually compute the integral of a function, usually what you try to do is to organize some specific patterns. For instance, if you see that there is like f prime times cosinus f for a particular function f in the function that you are trying to integrate, then it's likely that sinus f will actually be part of your primitive. So if f is a small function, that is easy, but if f is like a complex expression, it's going to be more difficult to notice this pattern. So it's really like some pattern recognition problem on neural networks. They actually exceed and they perform extremely well in this pattern recognition task. For instance, when you do image classification, what you do is that you try to detect some specific pattern in images, or if you want to classify sentences, you try to detect some particular subset of words. So here it's actually a little bit similar in this sense. The difference, though, is that neural networks operate on sequences. You cannot directly feed like an equation to a sequence-to-sequence model. And also, one of the bigger requirements is that they require a lot of data. If you train a machine translation system with, let's say, thousands or thousands of, let's say, English to French translation, then your model will actually perform poorly. These neural networks, they work well, but the requirement for them to work well is that you need to train them on millions or like dozens of millions of examples. For instance, in English to French translation, we use like typically 100 million sentence pairs. So you have basically a data set of 100 million English sentences with like the 100 million corresponding French translations, which you don't have like in function integration and differential equations. So we have to address this. Okay, so the outline of the talk will be the following. So first, we're going to see how we can actually make the problem compatible with sequence-to-sequence models. So how we can actually use sequence-to-sequence model to do function integration or solve differential equations. Then we're going to see how we can, I mean, what are the models that we use, and also how can we create data sets, because there does not exist any data sets of like dozens of thousands or millions of integrals on differential equations. So we have to actually generate them so we can train the model on them. Then we're going to see what is the performance of the models the neural networks train on this data set, and how they compare with like more like with like other solutions, like commercial softwares like MATLAB or Mathematica that have been used for many years and that are like well established and developed. And finally, we're going to discuss something which is important in machine learning, which is generalization, which is basically the question of if we train a model on a particular data set, do we have the guarantee that it will also work well on another data set, which is not guaranteed in machine learning? Okay, so the first problem is basically the question, how can we use mathematics as a natural language? Because basically, sequence-to-sequence models so far have been mainly used to translate sentences or to generate text. But here we work with not text, but with mathematical expression. So the way we do this is that we actually have to transform equations into a list of tokens. So a token can be basically, for instance, we have one token for sinus, we have one token for cosinus, one for tangent. We basically have one token for every possible function that we want to use. We have one token for x, one token for pi. And the idea is that our neural network model will have one embedding. So an embedding is essentially a vector. So we will have one vector for each of these tokens. And if we have a large number, so let's say, for instance, just a number like 1,214, the question is how do we give this number as input to a neural network? So here, what we do is that we split this into individual digits. So here, we're going to represent this as a sequence of 5 tokens. It's going to be like plus 1 to 1, 4. And the idea is that if there is, I mean, since there is like an unlimited number of integers, you cannot have an unlimited number of, you cannot have one embedding per per integer. If there are like 1 billion numbers, you don't want to have one billion vectors. So you split these numbers into digits, so you can actually represent any number using a sequence of tokens. And the other thing is that we do, I mean, the first thing that we actually do is that we take an expression and we transform it into a tree. And then from a tree, we can actually transform it into a sequence. So here we use this is nothing new. We just take an expression. And here, what we can do is just transform this into a binary and unary tree. So here, for instance, if we have 2 plus 3 times 5 plus 2, then the main node is going to be a plus, and we are going to add 2 to basically the multiplication of 3 with the addition of 5 plus 2. So this expression is actually equivalent to this tree here. And if we have this expression here, we can do something very similar. The difference here is that we have also a cosinus. So here, this is not a binary, but a unary operator. So we have a cosinus here that will actually take as input the multiplication of 2 with x. And if we have some more complicated expressions, let's say you have some, let's say you want to work with differential equations, so you want to represent the derivative, the differential operator in your input. So what we can do here is have a tree. And for the value, for the root of some trees, what you can have is the operator differential. So here, if we want to represent this part of the expression, we basically have a tree of depth 2, where the root node is the differential operator. And what we differentiate is what is on the left, and what is on the right is the variable with respect to which we differentiate what is on the left. So basically, this expression here can be represented as this tree. So the first thing that we do is that we transform our expression into trees. And once we have a tree, what we can do is simply enumerate the tree. So we do like, we use like prefix expression. So we simply transform these trees into prefix sequences. So for instance, if we have this expression here, we can actually enumerate the root node. We enumerate the tree starting from the root node. So we have plus, then we have what is on the left, it's a 2. And then we enumerate recursively what is on the right. So it's gonna be like times, then 3, then plus, then 5, then 2. So we start from the root, then what is on the left, then what is on the right. And then we can actually enumerate this tree into a sequence like this. So to summarize, we basically take an expression, transform it into a tree, and then from this tree, we can actually transform this tree into a sequence. And all the time, there is like a one-to-one mapping between an expression, the corresponding tree, and then the corresponding prefix sequence. And since we work with sequence-to-sequence model, what we are going to do is basically give as input to our models this sequence of tokens, and we are going to train our models to predict another sequence of tokens, which in the case of function integration, for instance, the input will be like a function, and the output will be like the token of the integral. So yeah, this is going to be like the input and output of our models. So now, as I was saying, so if we want this model to perform well, we need to have very large data sets. And unfortunately, there does not exist very large data sets of functions with their integrals or differential equations with their solution. So we need to find a way to generate these data sets. So for integrals, we propose three different ways to do this. So one is very simple. It's what we call it the forward approach. So the idea is that what you can do is generate a random function f, and then you can use some existing framework like SymPy or Mathematica to compute its primitive big f. And then what you can do is simply add f big f to the training set. So you add like a training example pair. And then what we are going to do is feed to the model small f, and we are going to train the model to predict the sequence of the elements that represent the function big f. So it's like the most simple approach to do this, to create a data set like this. The only problem is that, there are many problems, is that first of all, you need to require on some external framework. So you need to use Mathematica or SymPy or any other framework that can do integration. And so because of that, it's unlikely that you will be able to perform better than these frameworks if you train a neural network on the data that they generate. Sorry. The problem is that it's also very slow. For instance, there are functions for which Mathematica will take like dozens of seconds to compute the primitive, and sometimes it will actually just fail. For instance, there are many functions for which there exists a closed form solution if you want to compute their integral, but just Mathematica will not be able to find it. So again, you will only generate a subset of, you will only generate a data set which is composed of a subset of functions that Mathematica is able to integrate. So you will not generate like a perfect data set. So here are some examples of functions that you are going to generate with this approach. So here you basically have what is generated on the left. So here we randomly generated these functions. And then we ask Mathematica to compute the integral, and we found these functions. So here, what you can see is that the input is going to be very small and the output is very large. So here we train the model to predict what is on the right given what is on the left. So it's kind of, again, it's some sort of machine translation problem where the input is this and the output is that. And yeah. And what you can notice here again is that the output is much longer than the input, which is not always the case. That's what we're going to see with the other data sets. So the second approach to generate example of function with their integrals was to use what we call a backward approach. So here, the difference is that we do not start from the function to integrate, but we start from the integral itself. So we generate a random function, but we call it big F. And here we can simply differentiate it to get the derivative small f. And then we just add again f and big F to the training set. So the advantage of this approach is that it's extremely fast and it never fails. When you have some function, you can always compute its derivative. And I mean, assuming it's differentiable. And the problem though is that you will tend to generate functions that are extremely long, like the derivative are going to be very, very long. Typically, here are some examples of generated sample from this data set. So here we generated what is on the right. So we generated small functions. And if you compute the derivative of this function, you will get what is on the left. So here you can see that the inputs, so what we are going to give to the model is composed of, is basically very long functions and the output is very small. So you have very small solutions and very long problems. But okay, and the other problem was that if you take an expression like, for instance, this one that we had before, like x power 3 times log of x squared power 4, so the integral of this function is this very long function here. So the thing is that if you generate a function randomly, it's absolutely, it will never happen in practice that you generate this function randomly. I mean, the probability that you generate this exact function is almost zero. So basically with the backward approach, you will never be able to add some example pairs existing in your training set. You will only have function with a very small output and a very long input. You will never have something like this because the probability of generating a function like this is basically zero. So this is why we have a third approach that we call basically the integration by part generator. And the idea here is that we can generate two random functions, so big F and big G. We can compute their derivatives, so small f and small g. And given this formula, what we know is that if we know the primitive of f times big G, then we can actually automatically infer the primitive of big F times small g. Because big F times big G, we know what this is equal to. I mean, we know this function, so we know the product. And if we know the primitive of this, because we have already computed it and it's already in our training set, then we can actually automatically infer the value of big F times small g. And vice versa, if we know the integral of big F times small g, we can infer the primitive of F times big g. So the advantage of this method is that it generates a function that you will not generate with the other generators. But the problem is that it is very slow. But the nice thing with the last two approaches, the backward approach and this approach, is that you can actually generate very large data sets without relying on any external frameworks like Mathematica or SymPy. You can actually generate that using very simple code and no external API or framework. So here are some examples of functions and primitives that you will generate with this approach. So here we generated basically this pair, so where the input is again on the left and the output is on the right. So we are going to train our models to generate what is on the right given what is on the left. And now you can see that examples exist, like x power 3 times sinus hyperbolic of x, that has this particular primitive. We now have this in our training set, while the backward approach would never have given this. We would never have done this example with the backward approach, because typically this requires to do multiple integration by parts. And this is why the output is very long. So now we work with integral, but we also wanted to see if our model is able to solve differential equations. So here we have the same problem. We need to generate a data set of functions of differential equations with their solution. So what we could do here is generate a random differential equation and try to solve it. But the problem is that if you generate a random differential equation, you have no guarantee that there exists a solution to it, or especially not in a closed form solution, something you could express with symbols. So we do something a little bit similar to the backward approach, which is that we generate a random function, and then we try to see what is the differential equation satisfied by this function. So if we have first order differential equation, we know that the solution, I mean, there are many solutions, but they are basically all the same up to a constant C. So what we do is that we generate a random function. So to generate a random function, what we do is that we generate a random tree. And when we populate the leaves of the tree, we put some X on one constant C, so just one constant C. And what we do here is that we express the constant C in terms of everything else, so in terms of F of X. So to do this, so we basically solve in C. So it means that, I mean, it's here it's pretty simple. You can just move the X on the left-hand side. You can exponentiate this to remove the log. And if you put the X on the other side, you have that C, the constant C, is equal to X times exponential of F divided by X. Which means that this function is constant of X. So if you, because it's equal to a constant. So if you differentiate it with respect to X, it's equal to zero. So you have that this expression here is equal to zero. And now you can actually simplify this a little bit because you know that exponential of F divided by X will always be non-zero. So if you remove this exponential, you have, and then you multiply all of this by X, you get the following differential equation, X Y prime minus Y plus X equals zero. And then you can verify that this function is actually a solution of this particular differential equation. So overall, you can actually generate random functions with one constant C, do this process here, and then you actually get a differential equation satisfied by your random function. And you can also do this at the second order. So here is another example for the second order with, again, a simple input. So here we have not one, but two constants, C1 and C2. So we generate a random function with C1 and C2. Again, we are going to express one of the constants, so C2 here, in terms of everything else, so F, X, and C1. So we have that C2 is equal to F of X, exponential of X, minus C1, exponential of 2X. So this function here is a constant of X because it's equal to a constant again. So we can actually differentiate this with respect to X. It will actually be equal to zero. So we have that this big expression here is equal to zero. And similarly here, what you can do is again, express C1 because here you have C1 there. We can express C1 in terms of everything else. So you have that C1 is equal to this expression here. And now if we differentiate this with respect to X, we have this following formula. So exponential of minus X divided by 2 times F prime prime minus F. And if we simplify this by this factor, which is always non-zero, we get this following differential equation. And now we can actually see that this differential equation has indeed this particular function as solutions. So yeah, so here what we can do is generate like 10 million random functions with two constants, do this process, and then we will get like 10 millions of differential equations with their associated solutions. And we can do this again without using any external mathematical framework. Okay, so for the data set in practice, what we do is that, so for all of this process, we start from by generating a random function. And to generate a random expression, we do this by generating a random tree. So we generate random trees with up to like 15 internal nodes. And for all these nodes, we are going to populate them either with unary and binary operator. So for the binary operator, we have the addition, like subtraction, multiplication, and division. And we have all these functions for the unary operator. So exponential, log, square root, the trigonometric function and their inverses, and the hyperbolic functions. And yeah, so now we can actually look at how many expressions like this we can generate. So here you have different curves. The x-axis is the number of internal nodes of the tree. On the y-axis is the number of expression, I mean the number of trees associated. And L is the number of possible leaves of the tree. P1 is the number of possible unary nodes. And P2 is the number of possible binary nodes. And you can see that, for instance, if L is equal to 1 and P2 is equal to 1, you have that this is the number of binary trees. So this is like the number of binary trees, like the Catalan number that you can generate for this different number of nodes. And you can see that if you also allow your model to generate unary trees, you have more possibilities to do this. And now if you allow yourself to have like 11 possible leaves, 15 unary nodes on the 4 binary nodes, you have the blue curve, which is basically what is, I mean, which is in our case, is, I mean, this is the setting that we use. And if we have 15 internal nodes, we basically have like something like 10 power like 35 possible expressions. So we have basically an almost unlimited number of expressions that we can generate to generate data sets. Yeah, so here, just very quickly, so this is the number of examples that we generate for all of our data sets. So for the forward, backward, and integration by parts generators, we generate 20, 40, and 20 million examples. And for the differential equation, we also generate 40 million examples of input and outputs. And so sometimes we can have we sometimes have very long expression with up to like 500 tokens or like 500 tokens for the input of our differential equation. So the examples that I show here are only very short, but the model is typically trained with extremely long examples. Okay, so now in terms of results on how it compares with other softwares. So we compare the model with Mathematica, MATLAB, and Maple. So for the integration, we only compare on the backward generator. I mean, comparing on the forward generator will be possible, but it will be not very interesting because Mathematica will get 100% on this, because by definition, the forward generator is the function that Mathematica is able to integrate. So we evaluate the performance of the model on the backward generator. And here we can see that Mathematica has like 84% accuracy, while our model is basically almost at 100% accuracy. So the way we measure the accuracy for the model is that, so here we use like a sequence-to-sequence model. So the way a sequence-to-sequence model works is that it takes as input a function and it will propose several candidates for the integral. So it will say, okay, here is the top 10 candidates that I think is a solution of this differential equation or that I think is an integral. And what we can do then is just, let's say we're doing integration, we can take like one output of the model, we can just differentiate it. And if we retrieve the input, if we retrieve the function that we wanted to integrate, we can see that this was actually a valid integral of the input function. So here you have like three results with beam size 1, beam size 10, and 50. So beam size 50 means that we actually let the model generate 50 solutions, and the model will actually get a point. So it will score 1 point if one of the 50 solutions is actually valid. On beam size 1, you just let the model generate one answer and you consider that the answer is correct. I mean, if it's incorrect, you basically don't let the model generate another solution. And you can see that here the model has almost 100% accuracy. And in differential equation, you can see that Mathematica has like 77% accuracy for the first order, 61% for the second order, while the model will have, if you allow it to, let's say, make 10 guesses, propose 10 solutions, we'll have like 94 and 73% accuracy. So for differential equations, what we do basically is that we give as input to the model one differential equation. We ask the model to propose one solution. And what you can do is just take this solution, plug it into the input differential equation. And if it's equal to zero, it means that this was actually a valid solution. So we can actually easily verify whether the model outputs are correct or not. So we still need some symbolic framework to verify the generations of the model. But the idea here is that the model is very good at proposing candidates and solutions. And then we can actually verify them using a symbolic framework. Just one other thing. So here we actually use a timeout of 30 seconds for Mathematica, which means that if the Mathematica doesn't find a solution in 30 seconds, we actually consider that it fails. But in practice, we try to put 10 minutes, but this doesn't really change the results. Usually, Mathematica either returns the solution instantly or just doesn't find a solution at all. So here are some examples of functions that Mathematica is not able to solve, but that our model is actually able to solve, for which our model can find a solution. So for instance, the first example here is a function to integrate. So you have to compute the integral of this. So Mathematica is not able to compute the primitive, but here the model is actually able to find the solution almost instantly. So here it's basically the arcsinus of this function here. So interestingly, what happens here is that if you give to Mathematica not this, but if you slightly refactorize the denominator, so if you put 1 minus basically this square, so Mathematica recognizes that it's actually the form of the inverse sinus basically. So if you slightly rewrite this by 1 minus the square of this, then actually Mathematica can find the solution. But if you expand the denominator like the way it is right now, Mathematica just fails to compute the solution. And here you have an example of a first order differential equation that our model finds and that Mathematica cannot find. And here you have the same example for like a second order differential equation. So in this example, the model instantly finds the solution while Mathematica fails completely. So here are some other examples of generation, which I think are quite interesting. So here you have some input, which is a first order differential equation. So this. And the model, as I was saying, can propose different solutions. So if we have a beam size of 10, it means that the model is actually able to propose 10 different solutions. So here the model will suggest 10 different outputs. And whenever the model proposes a solution, it also proposes a score. So here, for instance, the score is typically like a log probability. So if you have a score of 0, it means that the model was confident with probability 1 that this was like the good hypothesis, the good solution. And interestingly here, what you can see is that all these 10 different solutions proposed by the model are actually all equal. All these 10 different equations are actually exactly the same, except the last one. But if you actually take a different value for the constancy, you actually see that it's actually exactly equal to this 9 other expressions. So interestingly, the model here was able to find that these 10 different formula are actually all equal, even though we actually never trained the model to do this. So we only trained it to compute the integral of functions, but the model was able to find on its own that these 10 different functions are actually all the same. Yes, so earlier in the talk, I mentioned that there were some differences with the generator that we can use for the forward, the backward, and the integration by parts. The difference being essentially that the expressions have a very different length. Typically, the forward approach tends to generate functions with a small number of tokens, but a small number of tokens in the input, so small input functions, but with a large number of tokens in the output. So the integrals are very long, like the green curve here. The backward approach was exactly the opposite. So we have very small inputs, very small integrals, but the outputs tend to be actually very long sometimes. And the integration by part method was actually a bit in between. So we have at the same time short inputs and short outputs. So in machine learning, what happens is that if you train one model on a particular distribution and if you test it on another distribution, which is very different, it will tend to perform poorly. So this is what we wanted also to investigate here. So what we can see on this slide is that, so we train 4 different models. We train one model on the forward data set, one on the backward data set, one on the backward plus the integration by part data set, and one on the 3 data sets that we concatenated. And for each of these 4 models, we basically evaluate the performance on the 3 data sets. So what we can see is that if we evaluate on the forward data set, we perform very well on the forward data set in blue here, but we tend to perform very poorly on the backward approach. Like functions to integrate that come from the backward generator, we don't even have 20% accuracy on this. And the backward approach is similar. If you train your model on the backward data set, it will perform very well on the backward approach with almost 100% accuracy, but you will get only 20% accuracy on the forward data set. So now what we can do is concatenate the backward data with the integration by part data. And what is nice here is that these 2 data sets were generated without using Mathematica or any symbolic framework, just like some very simple like Python code. And if you train a data set on this, a model on this data set, you will get like an almost perfect accuracy on this data set, but you will also get more than 50% accuracy on the data coming from the forward data set, which is basically the data set on which Mathematica is able to compute functions, integrals. And finally, if you train a model on everything, so on the forward data set, the backward, and the integration by part data set, we can see that the model gets an almost perfect accuracy, almost 100% everywhere, which means that if you know exactly the distribution of the function that you want to integrate, if you have a generator for this distribution and you train a model on this, then your model will perform very well on this distribution. But the only issue here is that we can never be sure that that does not exist. And there probably exists another distribution different than these 3 data sets where the model will actually perform very poorly. Maybe there are expressions that are not generated by the forward, the backward, and the integration by part approach that this model will actually not be able to integrate either, so, which is basically one of the main issues with machine learning. So finally, just some other results on generalization. So the forward model, so again, was trained on the function that SymPy was able to integrate. It's basically, our forward data set was generated with SymPy, which is like the Python equivalent for Mathematica, even though not as performant. And we only train our model on the subset of functions for which SymPy is able to compute the solution. And interestingly, at test time, what we found is that this model was actually able to integrate functions from the backward dataset that Mathematica is not able to integrate. So that SymPy is not able to integrate. So for instance, if you look at these inputs with these particular solutions here, these functions, our model is able to integrate them, even though SymPy is not, which is kind of surprising because in the end, the model was only trained on the subset of functions that SymPy is able to integrate, which means that in some ways, the model was able to integrate, to learn, to generalize beyond the distribution of SymPy. And okay, so that's it for the talk. So the paper is online as well as the code to reproduce the results on the pre-trained models. And I'm happy to take questions now.
Wow, cool. Thanks a lot. That was a great talk. So questions. I would encourage people, if they have a question, either to raise their hand or in case they think their mic doesn't work, then please to type them in the chat and I will read it out for them. And I can see we have one question there. Louis, please go ahead.
I wanted to ask a question about generalization. So if you have a particular expression you want to integrate, I guess you've got no real way of knowing whether it's sort of the training sets that you've used are similar enough to that function. And I guess you just have to differentiate the answer yourself and see if it works. Is that it?
Yeah, so basically if we are given a new function, so the thing is that our model doesn't know, our model can propose solutions, but it will never know for sure whether this solution it proposes are correct or not. So the only way to do this is to actually, yeah, we take a function, get a solution, differentiate it to actually see whether we retrieve the input function. And if it's not, if we do not retrieve the function to integrate, it means it was not a correct solution. So we can actually take another one, I mean, try another one. But yeah, so this model here is basically used not to replace like formal system, but just be used, I think, on top of formal systems. So you actually propose this candidate solution and then the formal system can verify whether they are correct or not. Yeah, you have no other choice.
I must say the whole thing looks pretty impressive. Just one other question, and that was you had this example where the sort of 10 best solutions, the best 10 solutions are all equivalent to each other, they have different scores. I guess the network doesn't know that they're equivalent to each other. Is that right?
Yeah, exactly. So basically what happens is that the model is generating one embedding. So like for each of these, whenever you feed an expression like this as input, your model will generate one vector. So it's basically one vector of dimension 500. And it will actually decode the solution from this. And here it will actually decode all of them, but it will actually, yeah, it means that basically there exists like a space of dimension 500 in which all of this expression, they have a very similar vector, like they are close in the vector space. But the model can suspect, but it will never know for sure that they are correct. Yeah. But in practice, it's kind of what we observe. If you have that two functions have a very similar embedding representation, even if they are written very differently, it means that they are basically equal. But yeah, it's we can never know for sure without like a formal system on top of this. Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, looks very impressive. Good talk.
Thank you.
Okay, there's also a question on the chat by Peter, who asks if you have considered the structure of the algorithms that are used by these symbolic packages like SymPy or Mathematica, and whether you have considered what first-year mathematicians are learning, and whether or not you think this could help to find better models that can do the same job.
So for SymPy, we didn't really dig too much into it. We basically took it like as a kind of a black box, like a package to basically provide us with the data set. What we tried to do though was to see whether we can understand what the model is doing by, for instance, looking at the attention heads, and basically it's usually, yeah, the problem with this model is that it's usually a bit hard to understand why they output this or that. They basically don't tell you why they actually output a particular thing or another. But there are ways to basically investigate this. For instance, the model can actually predict a token, and you can look at what it's looking at to predict a token. For instance, maybe the model will actually start outputting cosinus, and you can look at what it's looking at in the input before it predicts cosinus. But the problem is that when we did this, so this method, they were developed to analyze model in natural language processing. So for instance, when you want to understand why your model is predicting this particular label for a sentence. So we try to apply these same techniques to understand what is happening in the model. I mean, why it's doing this or that, but we didn't really, it's very difficult to interpret. We were not able to find like any new algorithm or something like this, even though, I mean, the model is definitely doing something, but we are just not able to understand what it's exactly doing. We will need to actually investigate this a lot more to understand how it's working.
I mean, please.
Yeah, thank you. Very nice talk indeed. I would like to connect to Louis' second part of the question. Have you considered training the model on simple, equivalently reformed terms? So we see here these selection of terms which are equivalent to each other, but the model doesn't know it. Mm-hmm. But that's because the model hasn't been trained to know this. So, and this is a very cheap training. There is it's very inexpensive to reshape expressions in quasi infinitely different ways. So if you were to do that, would there be some hope that the weights that we see here would actually become much more similar, and the model in that sense would start to know that these equations are the same?
Mm. Yeah, it's a good idea. I think if we were to do this, we could actually train the model to do two things. So one is, the task that we have done here, so solving a differential equation, and the second will actually be we could actually train the model to map an expression to any other expression equivalent, or we could actually do something like train the model to basically match, what you could do is, let's say we have an embedding for this formula and we have another embedding for this formula, so two vectors. We could actually train the model to minimize the distance between these two vectors. We could say, we could add to the loss, minimize the L2 distance between these two vectors. And actually, it would work. Yeah.
This element on its own would already be an ingredient that would help existing packages like Mathematica to improve the integration ability, because as you've just seen, you've actually put up an example of that same problem that Mathematica has, is able to integrate the same function if only it is written in a differently factorized way. So if there is an element that can simply re-represent elements of functions in different ways, then using those in conjunction with your standard symbolic packages can already be a big step forward.
I think so. Yeah, I mean, there are definitely some ways to get some gains into Mathematica. I mean, I'm not sure exactly what people would be interested in here, but for instance, here the model was not working. I mean, Mathematica didn't work because the denominator here was not factorized. On having a model that actually detects this expanded expression on how they can be factorized, it's actually very simple to do for a neural network. Yeah. And actually, it will be, I think, possible to take a model that as input functions, normalize them by either factorizing them or rewriting them in a way that are easier to understand for the above model like Mathematica. And yeah, I think these tools like Mathematica and any neural network will work well together. And I think it's definitely something that will happen at some point. Only issue is that the neural networks are a bit expensive. Typically, it's better to have like a graphic card, or it's a bit slow. It's not that bad, but at some point, I mean, it's obvious to me that in the future, these tools will be integrated in Mathematica, I think, because they will always be able to do things that we can actually not write with we had a look at the SymPy code very quickly for integration. It was really, really complicated. And it's obvious that a model that you can actually train like a black box like this and that performs so well should actually be useful for these problems, I think.
Thank you.
Yep. Okay, Will, your question, please.
Hi there. I take it you train the numbers on like decimal symbolism, right?
Yeah.
Is that okay? So do you have like any idea of like the limits you can take the model's understanding of the decimal number system too? I mean, even in like simple algebra, is there a limit up to which that it can either multiply or divide?
So I very quickly talked about this at the very beginning. So we had initially like one way to represent this. I think in the end, in the problem we used, we didn't have any float numbers. We implemented that at the very beginning. I think there were other things we wanted to try, like for instance, see if from like some approximated solution of an expression that can be written in closed form, the model would be able to actually detect the closed form. So for instance, if you have let's say some approximated function, can the model look at this floating numbers and detect that, yeah, this is definitely looking like cosinus of this, and can we actually map this floating representation to the associated like closed form formula. But that's something we wanted to try, but we didn't really investigate that. So I'm not sure how it will work with the floating numbers, because in the end we didn't end up using them for the integrals.
Okay.
I'm not sure, sorry. Yeah.
That's a perfect answer. Do you have any idea like whether this is good at just kind of like reordering? Have you tried it on more abstract reordering where you kind of just entirely randomly make up the problem that you have a set of rules in which the symbols can be reordered and then train it on that?
So what we tried to do, so I don't know if it's exactly related to what you have in mind. So what we tried to do is, for instance, if we have expressions like, let's say A plus B, where the model is able to integrate A and the model is able to integrate B, so automatically it should be able to integrate A plus B by just summing the integrals, but somehow it happens that the model is able to integrate A and B and A plus B, but not B plus A. It happens, it's not very common, but we found some examples like this, where just something that should be automatically doable for the model are actually not. And we actually found a few instances like this, where the model is actually not robust to this very simple modification. If you just, A plus B is working, but not B plus A somehow. But
Do you have any ideas to like use like a GAN architecture in order to have one model producing more difficult problems and another model solving them at the same time, or do you not know if that would work?
I think it's a good idea. I think only difficulty here will be that as far as I know, we still don't really know how to use GAN for sequences yet. People have tried that for quite a while, I feel. I even spent quite a bit of time on this like a few years ago. But the thing is that when you basically want to differentiate, let's say your GAN generates something, that's an expression, let's say F, and the model is not able to solve this, then you want to give this feedback to the model, but you don't know exactly how to do this. I mean, there is no like continuous signal you can backpropagate through this discrete generation of tokens. So it's like discrete output, so you cannot differentiate with respect to that. And because of this, we don't really know how to do it. GANs are working well in images because like when you generate an image, basically an image is like a matrix of float numbers between 0 and 1. So we know how to do this well, and the signal is going through these images pretty well. But we don't know how to signals through the tokens. So, it would be, if we had a way to this, I think it should work, but we don't know how to do this yet in deep learning.
Okay, thank you very much.
Can I ask what the structure of your network is?
I didn't talk too much about this. So it's basically just a transformer model. So there is this paper, like the Attention is All You Need, like that presented the transformer architecture like in a few years ago. And we basically use like the vanilla implementation of this model. So it's like a 6 layers model with dimension 500. So it's a pretty small model. And something interesting that we found is that actually the model performs pretty well even with very small with a very small number of parameters. Like in natural language processing, usually for the model to work well, you want to have like 10 layers or dimension 1000. But in our case, we found that with just like 6 layers or even like 4 layers of dimension, like 100, it's already pretty enough to have like a pretty good performance. Which also means that, which is nice, because if you wanted to use this maybe in like in some symbolic framework like Mathematica, you will actually be able to put a very small but still very powerful model. But yeah, we just use like the vanilla sequence to sequence model of the initial paper.
There's another question on the chat from Herschel, who is asking about your compute requirement. So how many CPU or GPU hours did it actually take to get to that performance?
So it's very fast, actually. You can just train like a model in a few hours, even on one GPU. I mean, I suspect if you train it on your laptop without GPU, it will also work after like 1 or 2 days, which is also, yeah, again, one of the nice things with this data set is that you can train on it very quickly, unlike in natural language processing, where you really want to have like 8 GPUs. Here, we try to scale it, to scale the model to train on like 32 or 64 GPU. But the performance was basically the same as with just one GPU. So you can train this with a very small architecture and hardware requirement. Yeah. Only thing that was a bit expensive to generate was the dataset. For the backward method, you can generate the entire like 40 million examples like very, very quickly. It's super fast. However, for all the other dataset, it was a bit slow because, I mean, typically, so for the forward, you basically, if you want to generate a training set of size 20 million, you basically want, I mean, you have to call SymPy or Mathematica, at least 20 million times, plus then all the other times where you actually feed an input function, but then Mathematica will fail. So it's actually pretty long. And, but the backward integration by parts are much faster than the others. So I think the limitation is that the difficult part is to generate the data set. The rest is very inexpensive. But we release the data set if people want to try running models on this.
Okay, thanks. I see no more questions. So let me maybe ask one last one myself, which I apologize for it because it's a very open-ended question perhaps, but do we have any intuition for how far this approach can be stretched? So in other words, is it conceivable that you have a model that you train on all the true statements that you generate starting from some axioms, and then you expect it to have some intuition for, if you give it a certain theorem, whether or not that has a proof in that axiom system?
Yeah, it's, you mean like theorem proving basically?
Yeah, exactly.
So it's exactly what we are working on right now. We are considering like several systems like Alllight and Metamat. It's a bit more difficult to work with than this because here what we do is that we basically have an input and we generate like one solution and then that is just like one step. You have an input, you generate one candidate solution and it's done. It's either correct or not. For theorem proving, you have to do this kind of MCTS tree search where you have like one goal, you apply a tactic, you get like some sub goals, you try to solve the sub goals and you do this recursively. So you very quickly have some gigantic tree, and it's a bit more challenging and much more difficult than this problem. Also, the systems that have been developed the formal systems have been developed, I think, without machine learning in mind at all. So it's very difficult to plug some model on top of like Coq or Alllight typically. But that's still work in progress, so I don't have so much to say currently, but.
Great. So any last words, any last minute questions? If not, then I would like to thank you very much again, Guillaume.
I've got one more question, sorry.
Will, go ahead.
In terms of that theorem proving, are you looking at more kind of abstract algebra terms? Are you looking at so-called harder problems? I don't really know how to describe it very well, but
So we use, I don't know. So for instance, in Alllight, you have like the you have the proof of the Kepler conjecture, which is there. So it's like a lot of theorems, a lot of statements, a lot of definitions. So we just use that, and we have like 30,000 proofs, formal proofs that we actually split into like sub proofs, and we actually like, we have like 30,000 trees, and we take a small subset of that to make a test set, and this is like what we use to work. The issue is that it's very difficult to generate large data sets. I mean, these techniques of forward, backward, you cannot do that in all light. But the math, the mathematics it covers is pretty wide. I mean, I think there is pretty much, there is not everything, but there is like complex analysis, group theory, a lot of stuff, arithmetics. So we basically just, we work with this data, but we don't really understand the data ourselves. We just give it to the model and it figures what to do with it. It's a bit difficult to interpret. Sometimes the model is suggesting some tactics, but you have no idea whether it's a good idea or not. You just try it on the, we are not familiar with the formal systems really. So.
Okay. Just one more. I don't know if you use like a kind of word to vec kind of pre-processing for your sequences. But if you do, do you find that there's any kind of underlying manifold structure in the kind of the clustering of objects or symbols?
So we don't use word to vec, but there is some sort of manifold. It's basically like a bit related to these equivalent solutions here. So here we have 10 different solutions, and if you look at their embeddings, the location of their embedding in the vector space, they are actually very close to one another. And similarly, if you have something like, if you have like cosinus of 2x, you will have an embedding for that. And if you have the other formula, which is equal to that, like 2 cosinus square of x minus 1, it will actually have an embedding, which is also very close to that. So we observe that similar functions have an embedding, which is close in the space. But we observe it. Word2vec could actually be more at the token level. And here, if we actually plot the embeddings at the token level, I think we will have that the sinus and cosinus are nearby, but since there are not so many tokens, I don't know if there is so much to get out of that. It's interesting for word embeddings because you have like, if you work with English, you have dozens of thousands of words, so you can observe things. But in our case, I don't know at the token level, it's not as interesting. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay, there's one last question by Yang Hui, who is asking, a question in connection to a recent effort or collaboration by Google, which they call the Ramanujan machine, where they try to generate new identities, continued fractions, and so forth. And whether you had any idea of how this connects to your work and whether you could use models or your approaches like yours to generate new identities.
I'm not entirely sure, but I believe the Ramanujan approach was more like some, wasn't it some like more brute force kind of approach? I forgot if this was using some machine learning or not. I actually don't really know the paper very well, so I don't have like an interesting answer about this. Sorry. If you wanted to find some identity, I guess what you could do with this approach is, there are things you could try. For instance, maybe, you could generate like a random formula. Exponential of square root of n, the whole divided by n plus 1 or something like this, and evaluate this for n equal like a bunch of different values. And then you could actually train a model to retrieve the original formula given the evaluation of this formula at different points. If you had something like, there was a story with Ramanujan, and we knew the evaluation of the number of partitions of an integer at different points, but we didn't know what was the exact formula for this. And then you can have some intuition about the formula and just write it down immediately like you did without having a proof for that. You could maybe try something similar with a network by just generating random formulas. You can do this for an unlimited number of equations, evaluating them at some random points, and then see if the model can retrieve them. It's something we slightly considered, but didn't really have time to investigate much more.
Okay, now that was it. Wonderful. Thanks so much again, Guillaume. That was really great. And thanks a lot to everybody who has asked questions. And that's it for today. See you next week. Yeah. Bye.
Thanks. Thank you, Rod. Thanks.
Bye, everybody. And thanks for the talk.